So, right, so the focus is on large-scale mobile systems. And it's implicit that they are wires. And it's a trend, let's say, we've been probably witnessing for quite some time. Actually, I picked this cover from The Economist that talks about when everything connects. That actually coincides with my previous visit at UMD back in 2007, presidentially. And it already said, I think it came out almost the same time that I was visiting you back then. And of course, it kind of motivates the need about security and privacy, and even characterizes back then a, let's say, unpracticed art. Of course, there's a lot of progress has been made across the community, and what I will be focusing on this for this talk is two characteristics of the systems which are emerging, and they seem to be catching up and catching on, if you wish. The first one is vehicular communication systems, where you have vehicles that have a lot of sensors on board, and they're aware of themselves and the environment, and they're actually passing this information, this yellow arcs you see here, to other vehicles and to some roadside infrastructure. And the idea is there to enhance transportation safety and transportation efficiency. That's why we're actually including this new piece of technology on board the vehicle. And the vehicle, in some sense, is becoming some sort of powerful computing platform and sensing platform. The second system, which is still to catch on at the same say level as the vehicular communication systems, is what we call urban sensing systems. You have on you, on your mobile phone or your car, sensors which actually can measure the environment, and you can take advantage of those without deploying a dedicated sensing infrastructure, in the context of what we call nowadays smart cities. And this is an upcoming trend. Now, we're taking these two systems as the substrate or the motivating systems or applications, if you wish. And we're going to look at security and privacy for those. Why? Because essentially, if I were to put it in one line, if you try to deploy those very attractive technologies without paying attention to security and privacy, all that you will do is that you will probably open the systems and their users to new vulnerabilities. And rather than getting the benefits, you probably backfire and you will get new threats and new new ways to harm everyday business and everyday life. So these two systems and, at the end, location-based services, which actually it's a very useful component and can complement both the previous two systems. How to secure and how to provide privacy for the users of those systems. And this will be through specific architectures. And I'm choosing those because there's a commonality of ideas across the systems or the way to provide security and privacy. And I emphasize the end there because we do want secure systems and privacy protection for the users. You cannot do, or you should not do, one without the other. And the spotlight, let's say, the common denominator in this, this presentation will be the identity credential management, the authorization, and essentially, if you think it in a slightly different way, security as a service or as an enabler towards deploying those systems. So let's get started with the vehicular communication systems. To begin with, that will be relatively shorter in the sense that it will also connect back to the previous seminar I gave back in 2007 at Maryland, but I will just fast forward to the last couple of years of results that we have. The adversaries, and then this model of is a generic model of adversaries that actually is relevant for both, for all systems, the whole discussion today, is that could be arbitrarily misbehaving entities, mobile nodes, compromised software, etc. There's a specific case that we are interested in, what we call civil users or civil entities or civil nodes. You could have adversarial entities that could present themselves as more than one entity in the system. These are internal adversaries and could be more harmful. We'll discuss more about them down the road. You could have collusion, you could have those working together. The flip side, you could have selfish users, and then when it comes to the infrastructure or what traditionally we tend to think as trusted entities or trusted third parties, we look at honest but curious adversaries, entities that will execute protocols faithfully, in some sense, according to the specification, but they are there to infer as much information as possible on the users that are registered or they operate with. And we'll get into that in a minute. So, vehicular communication systems, what are we looking for in terms of security and privacy? Here's an example where you have a vehicle that communicates with other vehicles on the roadside infrastructure, and you can think of this as an example where you buy a hacked version of the software in the vehicle, and then your vehicle pretends to be an ambulance or an emergency vehicle, and everyone else is actually yielding and slowing down while you're passing by. And that would be an example of misbehavior that could be very attractive even to selfish users. You don't have to be outright malicious to use such a gadget. What do we want to do is basically stop this kind of misbehavior and a whole gamut by expecting that vehicular communication will be authenticated, we can corroborate who's actually sending, or can corroborate at least that this is a legitimate participant in the system, that no one can modify transmissions in the system, that no one can deny having sent information in the system, can say who is allowed to do what and who's allowed to access what kind of information. And the trick here is, how do you combine security with anonymity, and what the community has concluded on, and this is industry and research community, is that, but mostly motivated from the industry side, you need, and the legislation side, you need conditional anonymity, in the sense that at some point you need to revoke this cloak of anonymity in case of some extraordinary situation or some sort of misbehavior. And when it comes to linkability or unlinkability, ideally you want to have unlinkable transmissions over time, but then safety, transportation safety applications require are quite demanding and require some level of short-term linkability. And then there was a compromise that was made in all the efforts in this area. Now, in a very short, let's say, or oversimplified term, what does this mean? It means that essentially you use public key cryptography to digitally sign vehicular communications, V2X, meaning vehicle to vehicle or vehicle to infrastructure communications. And there's a proposal that is not yet standardized to basically combine this with anonymous authentication in order to have some sort of extensive flexibility. And the essence, or what basically deviates from what one could expect to have it as a signature and some sort of certificate, is essentially that you scrape this off and then you have an anonymized credential that doesn't actually reveal or doesn't bind the identity of any entity to a public key, but rather attests to the legitimacy of the participant. And this is what we call, in this case, a pseudonym. All right. And there's been a long process since the first field demonstration in 2008 that we took part from the security viewpoint. Here you see a full trunk of full of equipment, and back up to 2015, where here you see two automotive boxes with a piece of hardware acceleration in the middle. So essentially things got shrunk, I mean, but then we are not there to basically deploy at full-fledged scale. But then there has been a lot of progress with a lot of attention to standards and to implementation and to constraints in terms of resources. Now, what I would like to basically put more emphasis on for the rest of the talk is not how do you basically secure vehicular communications from all sorts of aspects that have to do with efficiency, have to do with, for example, communication protocols, the security that you achieve, all sorts of configurations and so on and so forth, but focus on how you basically enable such solutions that provide both security and privacy by having some sort of public key infrastructure, or what we tend to call a vehicular public key infrastructure. And the idea is that you essentially separate between two types of certification authorities. The first one is what you call a long-term certification authority. And you can think of this as the home domain of the users, or the vehicles in that sense. These are the onboard units that basically get registered with the trusted third parties. And this is responsible for keeping track of the long-term identity of the bee. And then you have pseudonym or pseudonymous certification authorities, these PCAs, which could be multiple, and their sole task is essentially to provide to those that are legitimate participants in the system these sets of short-term certificates, anonymized certificates, these pseudonyms. Now, why am I saying that they have to be sets of certificates? Because if you want them in capability and you're using even an anonymized certificate and you digitally sign messages you send, it's trivial for anyone that obtains a transcript of those communications to basically link them together, because they cannot be verified with the same public key. While if you're changing over time from one anonymized credential to another, messages can be linked only during the period that you use the same private key to sign messages that can be, signatures can be validated with the corresponding private key. Once you switch to the next one, at that level, let's say, of representation, you cannot link. There are other ways that you could possibly link transmissions, but this is, let's say, for the time being, out of scope of this discussion as we're having it now. So you have these PCAs, which basically are there to, in some sense, provide the vehicles with another kind of fuel, which is these anonymous credentials, so that they can go on, participate in the system, and still provide a level of protection, a level of privacy protection. And these systems, they will be deployed. I will show a picture in a short while, so it will become a little clearer. They will be parts of different domains. For example, you have the state of Maryland, you will have the state of Virginia, and so on and so forth, and each of those states will be responsible for registering the vehicles, and this is some sort of analogy to the DMV that we have now, or it could be the car manufacturers that will be running some of those entities. This is not something that is certain yet. There are, let's say, different ways that could be implemented. But what we care is to have these large systems of systems that enable vehicles to basically interact securely and with privacy protection. And this means that we need a system that eventually will work in such a heterogeneous environment. And we need some sort of trust establishment between these trusted third parties, either through some higher level certification authorities or through sort of cross-certification. Again, this is an organizational matter that is not settled. And in the end, we want some entity that will be able to basically initiate a process to basically resolve an identity, essentially lift this cloak of anonymity that we want to have, in case of, for example, an investigation, an accident, and so on. So when we design a vehicular public key infrastructure, we want to make sure, exactly because now we have this new notion of short-term credentials, many of them used by any vehicle and can be obtained by any PCA, we need to make sure that no one can actually manipulate the system and start obtaining certificates from different PCAs and essentially start posing as multiple entities. Why would this be dangerous? Because think of a protocol that relies on how many reports of a given kind or how many messages of a given kind have been received. For example, you're collecting data and you try to figure out if there's a traffic jam, or you try to collect data to figure out if there's an accident. If you have one saying that there's an accident erroneously, but then another 10 cars around it saying nothing, then of course you could reject such a claim. But if you have an adversary that can pose as 10 malicious nodes, then you can actually mislead you into believing that something is happening while it's not. And you want to make sure that things are efficient. So that's a picture that essentially illustrates what I was discussing before. You have different domains, so here I'm using the example of two different European countries, and you essentially want to move seamlessly from one domain to another without standing out, and you have, for here the whole idea is that you have a vehicle that interacts first with the long-term certification authority, obtains a token, what we call a ticket, that allows it to go to any of the PCAs within a given domain, a trust domain, and obtain the pseudonyms that it requires to authenticate all its transmissions. And then if it needs to go to a new domain, it accordingly has to obtain pseudonyms from that domain. Why? Because you don't want a one single Swedish car, no matter how well anonymized it might be, standing out in a crowd of German cars in this example. And here I'm just showing some sort of directory service to facilitate access if you don't know exactly where are and which are the entities to contact as you're roaming around. So let me show you a little bit the what happens under the hood, and then we'll move on with some performance results, and then we'll close this chapter of the vehicular communications, and we'll move to the urban sensing. So first you figure out which LTCA, which trusted the party you talk to. I mean, let's not dwell on this part. And what you do is that you submit a request to obtain this kind of authorization token. In this case, you say, well, I'm going to move, I want to obtain credentials in a foreign domain, so I want a foreign ticket. So what we do now is that you don't want to reveal to your home long-term certification authority which domain you're moving to. Otherwise, you provide information that could be used to link you trivially from your home. So essentially, you hide the identity of the foreign long-term certification authority, and then you say for which period you want to obtain this authorization, these two time instances, and if everything checks, basically you get this this foreign ticket. Now, this period of validity will become apparent in a minute. Why it's there, how it's used. So now, once you have your foreign ticket, you have this authorization token that says yes, that you are registered, but there's no revelation on your identity. You basically contact the foreign LTCA and you say, well, I'm here and I'd like to obtain pseudonyms, or actually I would like to get an authorization token, but I'm not revealing which PCA I'm going to talk to in order to obtain my certificates, because then there could be information in the hands of the LTCA to basically link, should it get a transcript of communication of that specific vehicle once it uses pseudonyms from that specific PCA, and essentially de-anonymize the whole process without actually breaking any protocol. But this is not happening exactly because you conceal the identity of the PCA. And then if everything checks in this request, because you present this foreign ticket, you obtain something that's called a native ticket, but now it's an authorization token that will allow you to convince that PCA that you are targeting to begin with, that you are a legitimate participant of the system without revealing who you are. And then here, you will provide a specific period, a more fine-grained period, over which you want to obtain credentials. And then, this is important because you basically decouple to a certain extent what this LTCA knows, or the home LTCA knew to begin with, from the actual period that you're obtaining credentials. So you reduce the possibility to use timing information to track your communication. And you provide a set of certificate signing requests in, let's say, 6509 parlance, and you, if everything again checks on the side of the PCA, then you obtain the certificates for the pseudonyms as we defined them before. And from that point on, you can go and enroll. Now, what does it mean from the viewpoint of forward? And here's a graph on your left-hand side where you see, as a function of the number of pseudonyms per request, and you can think of easily hundreds or tens or even a thousand of pseudonyms that you get at the batch, because you're transmitting in these networks at a rate of 3 to 10 times per second, and maybe you are using a pseudonym over a minute or a few minutes. So essentially, if you wanted to roll for quite some time, you could possibly need a lot of pseudonyms. And this is the latency to conclude this whole operation, broken down to networking, processing on both sides, etc. So first, the ticket validation is pretty cheap. This whole pseudonym provision is a relatively heavy one, but it's not so heavy. In the end, this is something in the order of a fraction of a second, or up to a couple of seconds. These numbers have been improved now in our current implementation. So what actually matters in this case, what I'm trying to convey, is that you could build this infrastructure, the Turkish infrastructure, even though it basically changes from what we know nowadays from the internet, where the interactions with the public infrastructure are rather infrequent, and still, in spite of the frequency, still have a public infrastructure that is quite efficient. We can rely on a cheap piece of hardware, relatively cheap. Now, here I'm showing you three figures. I will explain what's this picture about without going into details. Considering populations of a few tens up to 120 or 30,000 vehicles, mobility traces in extended areas, that basically we use to emulate what would be the load to a VPKI for that area. And what I'm showing here is delay, is that traces of delay, what delay each client that will access the VPKI will face, and this is actual implementation of the VPKI, for different pseudonym durations or lifetimes. One pseudonym good for 5 minutes, or one pseudonym good for half a minute, which is a pretty short period. And what you see here, this is the y-axis in all three plots for different policies of obtaining pseudonyms. I won't go into this, we can discuss it afterwards if you wish. So I see that here I have footnotes that show where all of these results come from, but once I pass the slides, you see it here, they're being cut off a little bit. So essentially you see that with pretty modest workstations, instantiating the PCA and the PCA servers, you have, in spite of some fluctuations here, you have delays in the order of less than 70 milliseconds, which are pretty easy to, let's say, digest from the viewpoint of the vehicle that is rolling and needs to keep obtaining pseudonyms in order to keep participating in the system. So that's the that's the message one I wanted to convey, and then these are ideas that now we use to a certain extent and actually expand them significantly when it comes to the second set of the second type of systems I wanted to talk about. Any questions so far? I mean, of course, we can take questions at the end, but given the first part of the presentation, anything that
yes, please. I mean, what you have here is sort of a proposal, right?
Yes.
But we live in a world where which is dominated by political, social pressures, and so on. So imagine that there is some terror attack somewhere, and the police needs to know or want to prevent it, even
yes.
by breaking some of the privacy.
Oh yes, absolutely.
How will you accommodate that system?
So, well, there is a revocation of anonymity or a full. A blown eviction of a node. So in this case that you're explaining, or you're motivating the question with, essentially this resolution authority that has, that's collecting, let's say, transmissions, basically would have to come with some sort of judicial order or, I don't know.
No, but that's per car. But if we want to do data mining in order
yes.
to identify that there is some activity that, you know, once you identify that somebody is a suspect, that's
right.
I can see that you have a reasonable answer to that. But
yes, or if you have some sort of I'd say reasonable motivation to say, hey, okay, out of this set of data, I want this to be extracted. So this is something that we haven't looked at. Essentially, all this work has been motivated by. Say the flip side of argumentation, when initially vehicular communication systems were presented and security architectures back, you know, a decade ago, we started, let's say, moving ahead. People in working groups, for example, in Brussels, were saying that what are you doing here? You're creating a big brother. So provide us privacy. So we actually, you know, catered to this need. Now, if someone has the processing power and the system allows it, so essentially you can basically de-anonymize any amount of traffic. Now, how would you do it in real time? I mean, I guess you basically now have to change the design and that, you know, introduce some sort of backdoors, etc., to make it easy.
Yeah,
for,
I mean,
but this is a big debate that I mean, for example, what happened to the Clipper chip, etc., in the past, somehow they swung, let's say, the way against having, you know, backdoors in the system. That automatically, let's say, here, in some sense, the system allows you to do it. And someone could even argue that, well, no, we would like to have even something even even more, let's say, private. But transportation, for example, beyond the example that you brought up, comes with liability attribution. That's one of the things we're going to have is an accident. We try always to figure out whose fault it was and so on and so forth. So the industry itself somehow motivated, in some sense, this conditional anonymity approach.
So I think anomaly detection is what I have in mind.
Yes.
For whatever anomaly you are looking for. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
You cannot tax to the excess. Other tax, you mean? Tax.
If you want tax, yeah, of course. So actually,
if you have suspicions in some, you can get permission legally and you can preserve it, but add on top of it tax. And then you can compare whether they're doing their normal motion or patterns or not normal motions, and then you can track more, and then you can even revoke anonymity. Is there anything preventing you doing that here?
So, I don't know what you have in mind on how you would do it, but then what comes to mind is that I could implant some malware on your, vehicular, your safety beaconing, for example, protocol stack. So, when you transmit beacons, safety beacons that look otherwise normal and they have detailed location information, if somewhere in the payload, you put exactly the tag that you make. And then that becomes a totally different question. You have to basically fight, clean up, make sure that your platform is free of malware. So then the architecture itself wouldn't do anything about it because it would be the payload that will actually link those. The only difference is that these tags won't be verifiably, let's say, or non-repeatably linked. Because
no, but I could do that with myself, right?
Yeah,
I can go and do particular tags on the emissions from the transmissions of the cars.
Yes.
If I get permission to do that,
yes,
I can be actually the benevolent attacker, meaning I can induce this into the system and then I can track you.
Yes, absolutely.
And if I get bigger permission, if the suspicion proves to be wrong, then I can really, that answers this question. Because I can actually track your car. And see, if you're not moving normally, if you're going, for instance, from France to Belgium and so on and so forth, where you're not going usually, then I can alert things. And if, for some reason, in the end, nothing happens, I can deliver. That's on top of the structure, and it assumes that I can...
You can infiltrate the system.
The question is, can you give me permission to do that?
I could, but then this is, let's say, the only architecture as presented, right? So it would be
possible to do that.
Yes, it has to do with the protocol stack, essentially.
Right. Because I'm going down now in the protocol stack and yes. Using something that I only know I have used and then I can track it.
Absolutely. I mean, so there could be even...
And even the person who's in the car, they cannot even know that I've done that.
Yes, because you have absolutely no understanding of what's actually going over the air. Yes.
Yes. The question is, in this kind of a vehicular system, do you have a requirement for different roles?
Yes. So you could have, say, attributes that actually are included in these anonymized credentials. If you wish,
this is what I'm asking, since if you're supporting attribute certificates.
Yes. Well, I mean, in these measurements, no. But yes, one could actually extend the. So the only thing that would change in this case is that if you have attributes, which, for example, even the traditional public key crypto actually provides now as it is, all of a sudden you reduce now the anonymity set for each of those. So you are one of the ambulances, you are one of the firefighters, you are one of the emergency, vehicles for the highway, or you are one of the, SUVs, etc., whatever it is. Because then one could actually, make it fine-grained and say, what kind of attributes do you have in terms of your sensing capabilities, and so on and so forth. All right, so I suggest that we move on to the next one, and then maybe after 15 minutes we will jump on questions again. So, a similar set of requirements now for participatory sensing. Now, see here, the connection to the users is much more immediate in the sense that, or could be more immediate, the sense that the motivation to deploy a vehicular communication system basically comes from the fact that either it will be mandatory, or because your insurance company would want to reduce your premiums unless you have it there to enhance your safety. Here, why would you let your mobile phone, for example, contribute data to someone that collects this data, even if it is for the common good? I mean, you could be altruistic, or you could be saying that, well, I don't want to waste my battery, or I don't want to basically reduce the quality of service I have when I'm actually doing whatever I'm doing with my platform. So there's an additional dimension of user incentives. And then essentially it's the same story that you want the user's privacy to be protected, and then you want the system to be protected, and you know, right. So here there's a misbehavior detection as a, which I could have shown as well for vehicular communication systems, but that's what we're after. Now, exactly because the landscape is somewhat more more complex, or it's, let's say, a different instantiation of what could be the vehicular communication system doing, we proposed an architecture entirely from scratch, let's say, without there are no standardization effort, that no constraints whatsoever, just prior literature, and then we moved on top of that. So you have someone like a city or an organization that wants to initiate a task that says, well, I'm interested in this kind of data, for example, noise levels in during night, or pothole information collection, or whatever it is. I mean, you name it, many applications could be there. And then you provide this task description now to an infrastructure that we put in place. And you see three entities, so things are kind of complex, but the reason is, I will explain in a minute. And then mobile clients register with this infrastructure. And then once they have the appropriate credentials, they provide samples. And then here, this aggregation service is the one that validates. And I won't go into many details, I just have a couple of slides on this. This is, let's say, a different dimension. Validates this data, tries to figure out whether they should be trusted or not, whether they are junk or not. And then provides receipts so that basically the clients can actually claim their payments later, their remuneration, whatever that is. And there's a flexibility in implementing this. So what I'm going to dig in now is how basically the interaction works between or with those entities, a group manager, an identity provider, and a pseudonym certification authority. This is, let's say, the commonality. We still use pseudonyms, this classic good old idea, because it's quite useful in terms of overhead compared to straight out anonymous authentication, and it helps us prevent from misbehavior in the system. So, zooming in a little bit, the user and these three entities, and you see there are trust associations between those, these red lines, dotted lines, otherwise things will not work. And what's the approach essentially? You have the user that wants to register with the group manager and essentially wants to obtain access to the system. He wants to contribute to one or more tasks. And once it gets this registration done, this initialization, it uses the identity provider as the entity that will attest to the pseudonymous certification authority that this user is a legitimate one and can obtain the short-term credentials that will allow it to start now submitting the measurements, this periodic or on-demand or whatever is the profile, whatever the task is actually describing, the measurements to the aggregation service. Now, why on earth do we separate those entities? Because it would facilitate deployment. If you wanted to bootstrap this, you could generate, let's say, an entity of this kind, and then basically establish trust and then cooperate with other entities, identity providers which are out there, or certification authorities which are out there. And because actually this is the way to deal with what you call an honest but curious adversary. So essentially these are entities that could be tempted to infer as much as they can about the user, the whereabouts, the context, the habits, the kind of data, the kind of interests it has, and so on and so forth. And it will become a little clearer when I explain how basically this works. So the group manager provides a private key, group signing key, and a group public key. You can think of any group signature in this context here. That could be a dynamic group signature scheme or a static, depending on what you're trying to achieve. We can discuss this later. and it provides you an authorization token dispenser. So basically, this is a set of values. There are n tasks that are currently registered in the system. You could be interested in anything, you know, reporting whales in the bay, or reporting noise or light levels, let's say, pollution during the night, and so on and so forth. And then each of those tokens is what you can use later in order to basically participate. And it has this kind of format. It basically is generated for the user that requests it. So it basically binds in an invisible manner the identity of the user to the task, for each task, and then says basically what the user is allowed to do. And this is signed by the group manager. Now, one interesting point is that you want to get this participation without telling the group manager which task you're going to participate in. Because I'll give you an example. If you say that I want to be measuring noise during the night time, in all likelihood, all the reports that you're giving will be coming from your home, for example, because that's where you will be, your smartphone will be during night. So you don't want to let the group manager know. So you can do this by using a private information retrieval approach, and in this case, we do a method of obliquous transfer. Now, once you have this token, what do you do? You generate keys, like what we discussed before. You send a pseudonym signing request, or a set of signing requests, to the PCA. But then, rather than getting your wish granted, the PCA basically sends a SAML request, an authentication request, back to you, and you forward this security assertion markup language for SAML. And this is basically forwarded to the identity provider that basically challenges you and authenticates you on the ground of the anonymous credential, this group signing key that you have. And then here you provide your token, essentially, the one that corresponds to the task that you want to participate and obtain credentials for. If everything checks on the side of the identity provider, without knowing who you are, it can attest that yes, you were verified. Of course, there is authentication between the PCA and the identity provider and encryption, right? So this, you're just basically relaying those, according to the SAML setup. And then you get the verification here, and then you obtain your pseudonym. And once you have them, you report your data, you collect your receipts, and then you can use them. And one thing to pay attention to, when you are the device talking to any of those entities, you should anonymize your communication in order to not be tracked by virtue of your identity, your IP address, for example. Now, what happens if there is a way to detect this behavior, or there is some suspicion, as we were discussing before? You get your pseudonyms, or a set of pseudonyms, or even a single pseudonym, or a method signed under the pseudonym, and you provide this to the PCA. And you say, I am doing an investigation, I want to figure out, I mean, here investigation is probably too heavy a word for an urban sensing system, but you try to figure out, you want to kick out someone that is probably giving you suspicious or useless data, right? To put it simply. So the PCA will give you the token, which was, if I show you here, which was pushed all the way from the identity provider to the PCA when the authorization was enforced, was provided. And then this token now is sent to the group manager that can basically correlate to the whole dispenser, send this whole dispenser to the identity provider, says, well, this whoever comes and asks for any authenticate or access to the system based on any of those tokens, you should deny. And then you can actually get this token dispenser sent to the PCA to basically revoke all the pseudonyms it has issued before. And you can have a variant that essentially you are not draconian, let's say, to go all the way, but then you revoke a user for a specific task only. It depends what is actually happening. Now, I will try to go a little faster. So here I have a slide that basically says that We thought exactly about the requirements we had to begin with, and we argue that these are achieved. What is important, for example, is symbol proof protection, which also holds for the vehicular communication systems, is that when you issue pseudonyms, you never issue more than one credential pairing per period of time so that you can oppose as multiple entities. What I will quickly go through is how you could basically gain some extra assurance that what you claim about a given system is correct, and you can use some automated protocol verification. In this case, we use this tool called ProVerif that allows you to model your protocol and then allows you to have an investigation against the common known Dolezal adversaries that basically can change or inject anything as long as they have the cryptographic keys to do so. Otherwise, they can just intercept everything but not modify. And this allows you to figure out that some quantities in the system remain secret, or you can even prove with a tool that someone cannot infer that a secret value changes over time. And this is useful for all these items or data pieces that are important for the operation of the protocol. And of course, we are interested in what this trusted third-party ensemble here can do, or quasi-trusted, let's say honest but curious. And what we also did is that basically we modeled the exchange of information between the two should they collude. And then to make a long story short, essentially you need any two of those entities cannot fully de-anonymize a user, but you need to have a more broader collusion. An interesting note before we go into the implementation of the results is that even though if the construction of the system, the separation of duties, actually allow you to even catch, if you go and a posteriori investigate, misbehavior from any of single of those. For example, if you have the PCA issuing certificates without having the appropriate token, there's evidence that the PCA misbehaved, and there's more discussion about this in the papers. Now, when it comes to the implementation, exactly because users could complain with, for example, such an application hogging the resources of their system, we built the protocol on smartphones, 2 core, 4 cores more, and then implementing TORs always, let's say, consuming more resources. And you see here how long it takes to obtain, for example, 50, 10 to 50 pseudonyms, and here everything is much more expensive than the numbers I showed you before. Because, for example, the cost of the oblivious transfer protocol, which is the order of a couple of seconds in this platform, or the whole operation of the protocol essentially could be quite expensive. But on the other hand, if you get 50 pseudonyms, maybe this is good enough, even if you use one pseudonym per report, to participate in a task for a few days. It depends what is the task description. So these few seconds is not something that you do.
What's the time, 20 seconds?
Yes, this is in the order of seconds, so it's quite high if you think. It's not a real-time system, but then essentially you do this for a few seconds, or this happens in the background while you're doing other things, and then you have the credentials to participate for a few days, and then maybe a couple of days down the road, you rerun the problem.
So the governments have flag you?
If you flood the...
I go in and pretend I'm 20,000 users, and I ask for this stuff.
So the...
Can I do a...
A clogging denial of service attack is always, let's say, part of the deal. Essentially, what you will be doing is that, let's say, you start asking the PCA. Well, at the moment that the identity provider will figure out that, this is not a valid request, the rest of the protocol will be aborted. But then, at least some crypto operations will have to be taken care of. So there, you have to resort to.
What if I do civil time? Okay, so I can. I thought you said you can protect against civil attacks. So
civil attacks, yes.
But if I have 10 zombies, right, that they go around, at a particular time, they all request it, then this system is going to die.
So a clogging denial of service attack, I mean, before, if you don't have any valid credentials whatsoever, the only thing I can do is basically mount some sort of puzzle mechanism, let's say, that basically makes you move around. And while you're moving around from server to server, each of those servers doing a minuscule delay while your network delay is higher. In the end, by the time you reach me, I add a couple of seconds to the overall delay, but I protect my infrastructure. That would be the approach. Now, if you're an internal adversary and you start misbehaving, violating the policies, then I can easily kick you out, and then I can make you an external one. Okay. So that's the more or less the way to, let's say, save our skin against it. But clogging and other service attacks, these are, let's say, in their simplicity. I'm sorry, all is there. Now, from the client viewpoint, what I'm showing here is the CPU consumption for different students, etc. Now, what might be interesting here for the four-core device, if you look at this 20-something percent of CPU consumption, I mean, we also measured the same kind of smartphone, that when you run your Facebook application, actually consumes like, you know, a little less than that. So one might say that, well, if you care to participate in such schemes beyond the remuneration you might receive, in the end, your phone, when you run the protocol, not all the time, right, would be spending time or resources, let's say, CPU time, roughly at the level of a Facebook application. So I'm not trying to make any great advertisement or say anything against Facebook, but I'm just picking a very popular one that everyone is actually running on his or her smartphone without sweating about resource consumption.
What's the implication of that on the energy consumption, the performance, the duration by which you stay on?
Oh, yeah, right. So I mean, what is like? There's nothing different than what would be the case for any other application. So it means that it's as if you run this application for a few seconds, then it goes silent, and then the only thing it does is that every few seconds or whatever is the task description, you send a sample. So I think that overall, smartphones nowadays, they exchange way more data than a few samples called. So that's not the issue. Now,
so this can operate on a, I mean, I have to understand.
Yes.
How you completely overhead. Because the tasks of using the services is bursting going into a task.
Exactly. So this is the consumption throughout the task for this burst or whatever. It's like now you run the protocol. Then it goes, it's slowed down.
Then I go to sleep or something.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so here, this is something on the flip side of the server when there's a failure, but let's not get into it because we are running out of time. And I won't talk about the privacy preservation with respect to the user incentives. This is out there. I won't say anything about selfish users that try to manipulate the incentive mechanism, for example, free riders or capitalizing on this without contributing and so on and so forth. Instead, I will quickly close this by saying, okay, location-based servicing, where does this fit into the whole picture? You collect this data, right? You have this service aggregation, or you have all sorts of data from vehicles, whatever is the collection. And then now, it's natural to make this available to users, and then the users will ask those based on their location information. So you get what is relevant around your location. This is, let's say, the KTH campus. Or the vicinity of this. And the adversary is now an honest but curious location-based server, what's actually cut down there. In the sense that the location-based server will provide you the information that you're looking for, but every time that you ask a question, you reveal where you are, what you're interested in, who you are eventually. And one solution that came out was to provide an anonymizer that says that, well, I am the trusted entity, that if you submit your queries to me, I will anonymize them, I won't do anything wrong, or I won't try to infer anything, and then I will send a set of anonymized or cleaned up queries to the server, get your useful answers, and then redistribute them back to you. That's fine. The only issue is that if you do not trust the MBA server to be honest and not curious, unless, I mean, someone might say that technically, why should you trust this other entity? And the answer to this, if you want to be, let's say, not dependent at all from a trusted third party that does this anonymization for you, is to leverage peer-to-peer interaction. So what actually you try to do is that, say, I am safe in some sense. I do not reveal anything to the MBA server as long as I don't submit a query to the server. But how could I get useful information without submitting a query? I'm asking my peers. If they have good enough answers for me, then I will go with this. And I'm partially exposing myself to those peers, and I will get to that in a minute, but I'm not exposing myself to the MBA server. And this is what we did a couple of years ago, but we assume that the data we get from the server, they are simply not verifiable, not non-modifiable in any way, and we did not make any assumption or any investigation on what happens if these peers that I'm showing here actually misbehave. What if they start flooding you with spurious answers or queries, as John mentioned earlier, or what if they modify data, which eventually you will detect, but it takes you time. So what we are trying to do now is to say, well, how can we have the best of two worlds, in a sense, the protection, the reduction of the exposure to the server, and at the same time, resilience against misbehaving peers, and let's measure what happens, how much we give away when it comes to the exposure to those peers, which if they all get together or they collude with the server or the infrastructure, then possibly they get to harm you. And surprise, surprise, if you need to have anonymous and secure interactions, we already have, let's say, a framework in place. Not that, you know, we have a hammer and we were looking for nails, but it came in handy. So we use the same notion of a long-term certification authority and a pseudonym certification authority, and we use these short-term credentials for peer-to-peer interactions and interactions with the location-based service. And the idea here is that it's relatively simple. At the time that you join the system and you obtain your credentials, the PCA assigns you as an assisting node. That from now on, for a short period of time, you will go around and you'll be helping in providing LPS data or point of interest data to other peers. And it's a small fraction of nodes. You announce the fact that you are essentially, if you think of, let's say, if you think it in a different way, you are infected with useful information that the others will come or can come and request from you. And what they actually do, they can actually obtain or request responses from more than one of those serving nodes, as we call them here, because this way you can cross-check the data. You can take exactly because this data come verifiably from the same source, which is honest, meaning that it's curious but not dishonest, you can be sure that if you figure out that there is a disagreement between these pieces of data, something went wrong, and you can be draconian, you can throw both pieces away. And when it comes to the exposure, we define the new metric here that basically tries to capture the accuracy of the reconstructed trajectories as you move by taking into advantage of the fact that you change identities over time. So essentially, there is a fraction of your trip you do over a given identity, over the total, and there is a fraction of regions that you submit queries from. You don't reveal yourself anywhere or potentially reveal yourself everywhere. And here are some figures that basically show you the exposure you get, this value of this metric I showed you before, as a function of the fraction of the serving nodes in the network, how many bad guys you have, and whether you use encryption in the peer-to-peer communication or not, because then if you have others eavesdropping, then they might get to learn more. And we even consider the case of the collusion with the PCA or even the long-term certification authority of the PCA. Assume a system where the LPS server actually deploys a bunch of, or hires a bunch of eavesdroppers or serving nodes to basically get information. What is interesting here is that overall nodes, the fraction of serving nodes that could misbehave actually is kept pretty low. In the sense that whenever you find you have a disagreement, you can basically evict that when it comes to active misbehavior, let's say, you can evict that that node. The second, nice measure there is that you don't have control if you're an adversary whether you will become, you will be appointed a serving node or not. So this is like a low probability, and if you are not, then you cannot harm the system. And this figure here basically tells you that the case that you care of, if you ask, for example, two responses per answer, what you actually should fear is the case of getting two false or, you know, doctored responses out of two, and then this is this curve down here, even if the ratio of the adversary is pretty high. And this is evaluated over real mobility data. So there is a level of, let's say, interest in this area. They're not totally, say, synthetic or imaginary. So this is the whole story. I mean, I had some slides here to talk about data trustworthiness, but I'll send you the slides and you'll see that it relates to the whole story. But this would be the let's say the basis for misbehavior detection without any assumptions on the model, the basis for the user remuneration. We need to try to decide whether this is useful and accurate information to obtain. And it can actually be changing dynamically as the model changes over time. Now, of course, all this work, I have to say thanks to a lot of people that collaborated for these papers, to members of the group and co-authors. And I apologize if I don't mention anyone, some people in this slide, but I provide some additional publications here. And that's all I would like to convey today. Thanks very much for the attention. Any questions?
Thank you very much.